Hello and welcome to another edition of Interview with DJ Nocturna. Please like, subscribe, comment, and share this interview if you like it. I'm honored to have as my guest the prolific composer, producer, and founder of the legendary band, the Cocteau Twins. I have Robin Guthrie. Thank you.
Good morning. Good evening, wherever you are.
Thank to you. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you for joining me. It's really an honor to have you. You know, I've been a big, big fan of the Cocteau Twins, and I actually have to put myself, when I was thinking of questions to ask you, I had to put myself when I was 16 and what I was thinking at the time when I first heard your music. And I would say, wow, I've never heard anything like it. It's so unique, the sound, the guitar, the voice, the vocals, but I can't understand it, but I love it.
Well, that's one of the beauties of being 16 is that you don't know everything in the world yet. So, you know, I don't know. I think that is a particular age where in the past, I guess, a lot of people made their foundations about, you know, choosing the kind of people that they wanted to be, you know, relate to music, or maybe that would dictate how they dressed. And, you know, teenage years, you're quite vulnerable because you're not really, you know, You're getting into life, and you know, it can be quite tribal. You know, people go, oh, I like this kind of music, so I'm going to have my long hair. I like this kind of music, and I'm going to have my short hair and things. So, you know, give yourself a break. You know, that's over now. You know?
Yeah, it was very memorable for me, I guess you could say. But you know, one of my favorite collaboration album during that time, during that early period of your work, was the collaboration with the late Harold Budd with the Moon and the Melodies album. Mm. That was definitely one of those favorites of mine, you know. Mm-hmm. And I know you met each other during that period, right, with that album. Was that
absolutely
one,
you know? Well, before we made the album, there had been talk of a TV show being done. It was like a documentary series where they got artists from sort of different realms, and they put them together in the studio, you know, and it was going to be sort of weird sort of things like metal guys working with reggae dudes and stuff like that, you know. And Harold, who I didn't know, Ivo was a great fan of, Ivo at 4AD, because he was, I guess, a big Eno fan, and he must have known him from there. I don't know. I met the guy and we just got on, and we got on for an awful long time, you know, regardless of music or anything like that. I mean, I wouldn't profess to be a diehard fan of Harold, as in I don't know all of his records and all of his work, and, you know, he's amassed a huge body of work. I'm not familiar with all of it, you know, far from it, but we related on a different level. We just had a good time, so, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed that you guys really had a connection. You know, he would say there was an age difference too, you know.
Yeah,
but you got along.
About 25 years difference. Well, you see, shortly before Garlands came out, I lost my father, you see, just a matter of a few weeks, not before it came out, before I made it. And that was quite, you know, I know this now with a bit of hindsight, but that was quite, you know, traumatic in my life as a teenager to lose my dad. And, you know, I just sort of fell into, I fell into the world with Elizabeth, because she was estranged from her parents as well. We were just kind of two young kids, 19 and 17, you know, who were somewhat disaffected and not quite grown up enough to really know how to handle these things. So we just threw ourselves into doing our music, and it was, you know, we kind of hoped that maybe one day we might be able to make a record. That was it, you know, and get the hell out of Scotland and, you know, see something and do something. So, yeah, so, you know, to come along and then meet Harold, having, you know, lost my dad so young, and here's this guy that's a fair bit older than me, and it was kind of like, I'm not saying he was like a father figure, but he was just like, I would always say, God, Harold, I don't know how come we're mates, you're so old, you know. You know, and, but then he would sort of like go into talking about life in the 50s and things, it's like, you know, Robin, so I'm watching Chet Baker and I'm thinking, hey, this guy's got no teeth. And it's just like, the man was adorable, you know, it's just, you know, I really miss him. And yeah, he was a very funny man. And yeah, he's known as being very serious and classical, and we couldn't be from really more different, more diverse backgrounds, you know, in terms of music. And like, he was very cerebral and wrote everything down on paper, you know that paper with the wee lines on it for music or whatever. And I'm just looking at me and I'm just going, yeah, just whatever, just no black notes, okay, please. You know, that kind of thing. So, and me with my kind of like, I'm not quite sure where to put my hands here, but I'll just give it a shot. So yeah, it was good. It was, you know, yeah. It's sorely missed, but at the same time, it's like, well, he was old, you know, so he lived a lot longer than other people. So
oh yeah, yeah, he did, yeah.
And cheers, you know, to him wherever he is. Cheers to him wherever he is.
Yes.
Coffee time.
Yeah, you know, his the last album that he collaborated with is Another Flower. With, you know, the last one that you guys did together. Mm. I know that one was recorded in 2013.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah, and but it was released 7 years. Was there? Why was it? Why was it?
It was recorded in this very room. So this is my work room, and this is where we made that one. We used to go to other places, you know, just we kind of have a look. We kind of have a look at the good hotel guide and go, I think we should go to Bordeaux to make a record. They have some nice hotels there.
Yeah.
You know, it's all right. Anyhow, yeah, moving swiftly along.
Yeah, I know you guys did that together, and then, but it wasn't released until 2020.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. And, you know, if there's any happiness in that story at all, it's the fact that it did come out before he passed. Because yeah. I don't think I would have released it had he passed before. You know, it's why did it not come out? Really nothing to do with us. There was some shenanigans with the record company and people representing Harold and a bit of bad will and a big busting up. So really not anything. It's very, for me, very, very frustrating because I went into a period of not doing very much music because, you know, I put my heart and soul into what I do and it's quite intensive. Mm-hmm. And, you know, perhaps if, you know, the recording session with Harold could be like 4 or 5 days, but then the time to like produce and mix it could be 4 or 5 weeks. So it's like, you know, it's an awful lot of emotional energy goes into something. And to have it sort of cast away because of politics was, you know, a bit of a kick in the balls, actually. So, you know.
I mean,
I'm glad that it sold itself.
It's a beautiful album.
Mm.
And I like how you worded something in there. You said recorded during a rainy summer in Brittany, 2013.
Mm. It certainly was a rainy summer, but it was rainy and stormy and like electric and close. And I find that a really extraordinarily inspiring sort of weather space to make music in. This might sound like really mental, but I have just got up. You know, working in stormy weather, apart from the fact that, you know, if we get hit by lightning, the studio gets knocked out. But, you know, when you have like it's really warm, so you've got the windows open, but it's raining really hard. Well, that's kind of subtropical weather. We don't get a lot of that here, but thanks to global warming, we're starting to get a bit more, you know, and that's such an inspiring.
It's warm here in Hawaii. See, I'm wearing a t-shirt.
Yeah, yeah, it's such an inspiring atmosphere to be in. It just adds that little bit more to whatever you're doing.
Yeah. Now, I also know you did some film work as well. You wrote for film.
I write for film. Everything is in the present tense. So, you know, because none of these things are over. I work at the moment. Back then I worked in the moment as well. And I tend not to look as far backwards as you do because I mean, you as in the public, because you perhaps attached some emotional value to what you were doing at the time that you had some of my older music. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not necessarily where I was at, you know. So film work, you said, yeah, I've done film work, some of which has been, you know, really excellent sort of experience for me because I get to use all my disciplines with different roles because suddenly I have to not just please myself, I have to help somebody tell a story. And I get the pictures on the screen and you know, it's just like, it's for me, it's just like, I'm a wee bit confused about how come I've not done more movie soundtracks because I think I'm quite good at it, maybe. You know, I like, it's a great process for me to do. I enjoy it. Sometimes, I mean, some of the things I've done has been very, you know, short notice. You know, it's the, hey, the movie's getting short in the festival and we've got 2 weeks to get the soundtrack together. It's like, oh, shit. It's like,
yeah,
that's going to be quick, you know. But other times it's like, you know, I get sent the script before the thing's even been shot. And I, you know, talk a lot with the director. We work out exactly the kind of vibe to go for. So, yeah, like I tried some TV as well, but the TV was, that was pretty hard because that was the turnaround was so fast. And, you know, yeah, that was just like a lot of work and an awful lot of it rejected and, you know, thrown away or, you know, because someone at the network doesn't want that or someone here, too many, you know, chiefs.
Oh, yeah.
That's quite frustrating, but, you know, it's good to try these things.
Yeah, no, it's great. And I read that some of your instrumental music is based on visual experiences that you had.
I think in general, all my music is, you know, I have to say that I've not actually, this could sound really bad, like I'm sort of useless or something, but I still do exactly what I did when I started in 1981. I, you know, pretty much, you know, when I started with Elizabeth and Bill, we made up some music in my mum's living room, basically. And then after that, by the time I got to Head Over Heels, from Head Over Heels onwards, I spent my time doing exactly what I'm doing here, sitting in front of a mixing desk with a guitar around my neck and with a drum machine here. And, you know, wind up forward 40 years, that's still what I do. So for me, it's a very linear, there's nothing new about what I'm doing at all. It's not really, I didn't have to change my approach to anything or, you know, it's, you know, that's how it is. So, yes, I'm quite a travel person. I really enjoy traveling. I really enjoy taking a laptop with me or a guitar or sometimes even both. And, you know, sitting in hotel rooms or sitting by the side of a lake or sitting up the side of a mountain or something. You know, sitting on a train is a good one. Amtrak across the US and created an album called Continental. You know, these kind of things where, you know, it's very visual. I mean, you know, I'm making instrumental music, but it's just that a wee bit more, I don't know, challenging to sort of tune into your emotions and the, you know, your neocortex, the front part of your brain where you're seeing things and transmitting that into something that's emotional. Of course, we all do that on a daily basis with our voice. A human voice, but I'm making instrumental music, so it has a different flow through, but definitely it comes from the back part of my brain. You know,
beautiful.
The animal part, the what do you call it, the midbrain or whatever, that's the emotional sort of area. And that's kind of maybe overthinking it, but that's what it is the morning, so you should hear what crap I'm going to come up with at 3 o'clock.
You know, I love your one of your project with Violet in Vienna.
Oh yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Siobhan. Yeah, I love Killer Eyes. That's one of my favorite tracks from Brulette.
Yeah, that was quite some time ago. That was that came about sort of post Cocteau's. Life was completely upside down at that point because everything I'd known as an adult suddenly just stopped, you know. And it was kind of obvious to me that there's no way that I could just go and get another singer because, you know, someone like Elizabeth comes along once in a lifetime. So
yeah.
I decided just to do something different. I met Siobhan because she needed some help with some production. Yeah. And we started to write songs together. Specifically, I started to write songs for her. Now, that's a bit more dramatic than it sounds because I never wrote songs for Elizabeth before. I made instrumental music. And when the instrumental music was finished, she came and sang on it. So I didn't really, and then, you know, sometimes I'll take away some of the things I've done to accommodate, you know, all her multi-tracking and stuff like that. But I never actually sat down in a room with someone with a guitar and wrote songs together in that way. So wow. That for me was quite a challenge. That was a new thing. And I decided, you know, when I met her, what was so charming was that, you know, she'd reluctantly come to meet me because her sister was a Cocteau Twins fan, but she'd never heard the Cocteau Twins before because
she was like a soul girl, a showgirl,
someone into, you know, church songs, Shirley Bassey, you know, people like, you know, from a completely different area of music. And I thought that could work, you know, because she's not got the baggage of someone trying to fill Elizabeth's shoes. Of course, the public didn't see it that way. They said, oh, Robin Guthrie, the wrong singer, which I think was very kind of small-minded. And another one of those crushing things that happen when you actually, as an artist, when you bare your soul and you put it out in the public and then you get that kind of negativity. It's, it doesn't really kind of make you want to pander to these people. It just makes me want to go the other way. It's like, fuck you then, you know. It's different. Open your mind, people. You know, but the problem is that a lot of people's minds, problem for me, perhaps not for them, problem for me is a lot of people's minds are stuck well, you know, in 40 years ago, 30 years ago, because this is nothing to do with me. This is because they had great moments in their life where some of my music was the soundtrack to that, you know. You know, remember those years in college, or, you know, remember that time I got off with that guy? It's like, you know, these kind of things. I said that because I'm talking to a woman here. you know what I mean? It's like ingrained into your, I'm saying you, everybody in general's life experience, but not necessarily so mine, because I'm from a rather different sort of view about that. In order, you know, I'm quite clearly not someone who just sits on my laurels, you know, and waits 40 years and then gets the old band back together because that was, you know, that was just the best thing. I want to recreate that. And that was just a part of a journey, and some of it was great. It was really good. I spent 13 years with a woman that I loved to bits, and we had a child together. I was in the band where I made the music that I wanted to make, the way that I wanted to make it. And we were kind of quite successful. Who could not say that was a good moment? But, you know, this is 30 years later. You know, that I acknowledge this was, you know, for all the goodness and badness, it was just something that passed. You know, I mean, put yourself in my shoes. If everyone was curious about what you did when you were 17, and then just fucking went on and on and on about it, it would get a wee bit old. And not and a bit creepy as well. So yeah, there we go. That's my thought on that. But anyway, moving swiftly forward into the 21st century. Yes.
Well, now you just released your first full length album in since Fortune called Pearl Diving,
I've released the this first full-length album. I've done other albums and things since then, but with other people, and I've been producing other albums and things like that. But this is me going back to making instrumentals and making myself happy with it. And I think it was just about timing. It's also about, you know, we mentioned Harold earlier. His passing sort of had quite a profound effect on me, because it suddenly made me realize that, you know, we're not here forever, better get on with it, you know?
It came out yesterday, right? It was released yesterday, I believe, the 12th.
But it was only just finished a few weeks ago. Just have this in my mind now that I'm really just going to make music and put it out. And all the traditional things that have helped, you know, I've been working in a very traditional way, old school sort of thinking for a long time about, you know, it used to be that when we made a record, or when I made a record, or whoever made a record, usually had to wait at least 3 or 4 months, or something, 6 months before it could come out, because of all the other elements involved, the promotion and the this, that, and the next thing, you know, lots of stuff. I'm just getting a wee bit impatient with all that, because what difference does it really make when you've got, you know, time to, if we can promote it right, if we don't have, don't promote it right, I don't give a, you know, just don't care, just want to get it out. This is cathartic, this is a really good thing. Why should I make all this music and then just sit on it? And I've been doing that for, you know, 10 years. I make a lot of music that I don't release, because I make a lot of music because I travel a lot, I get inspired, I do things, but they don't necessarily at the time have, you know, they're not part of an album, or they're not part of any project I'm doing. I just do it because it's kind of what I do, isn't it? So with that in mind, you know, after Fortune, which was 9 years ago, I sort of started to do other things. I toured a bit as well, that takes up a bit of time, but I also started to do other things in my life, you know, things that perhaps I should have done when I was 30 or 20, experiencing things that you don't really get to do when you're stuck in the studio all the time, you know. So that was really kind of cool and very creative, and it all sort of works for me, because, you know, I think I'm definitely someone who needs to go through life experiencing that feeling you have at the end of the day when there's something new that didn't exist that morning, you know. I'm not really happy with the service part of the endless tedious emails.
That's true.
Stuff like that, it's really not that doesn't really I'm a bit slack with that. You know, but you know what, I used to say when I was in Cocteau's that I had the best job in the world, because I could just do really my music the way I wanted to do it, and I still feel that way. It's a privilege, you know, it's a really good thing, but it's also a necessity to, you know, on an emotional well-being type of way, you know, a mental health kind of way, it's really necessary for me to do this.
Yeah, you know, I love the song Castaway, and Presence, and Ivy. I like that one too. So if anybody wanted to find the music for Pearl Diving, the Bandcamp, right? There's Bandcamp.
There's Bandcamp. There's Spotify. There's Apple. There's, you know, record stores. There's, you know, I've taken it upon myself just to engage. I'm pretty useless at social media. That's not a technical thing, that's just a social thing, probably. But I've sort of engaged with the Bandcamp community because, well, I can just get my music directly to people, and I can respond to them and get feedback from them. And you don't get that if somebody buys your record on Amazon, you know. It's So, you know, I know that an awful lot of people don't use Bandcamp, which is fine as well, but it's as a way for me to sort of combat the feeling of, you know, having to wait 3 or 4 months or whatever after I finish something to get it out. It's fairly instantaneous. I've not done this yet, and I'll say this out loud so it has to come true, but I'm gonna try doing some music. I'm gonna start something in the morning and have it posted by the evening.
That's my next little
that's purely to amuse myself, really, or just test myself, or just have a bit of fun, or just have a experience the liberty of being able to do that.
Yeah,
you know what, the worst thing that can happen is it gets to be like 6 o'clock and I haven't finished it yet. Oh well.
Yeah,
well, I'll do it tomorrow, you know. So
yeah, I was gonna ask you, like, what's coming up next, or any other projects, film, anything?
I am doing a remix for someone at the moment in the United States. I've got a song that I've just mixed by my buddies Heligoland, who have got together with an Italian group called She Owl, and they've done a cover of a John Martin song, and it's pretty spectacular. That's really good. I have an EP coming out on December the 3rd called Riviera. I've not really announced yet, but I will. And then I'm going to have another EP out in January.
Oh, okay. Before,
which is my birthday. And then I'm going to be continuing into that year. I have several other projects. I'm not, you know, I'm here now. So I'm just going to, you know, brighten up my life by doing something. I don't, you know, if I'm doing, you know, a couple of years ago when I wasn't doing, putting records out like this, I was still making them.
Yeah, you're always making music. There's so, you know, I mean, you released so many albums after the Cocteau Twins, and they're all wonderful.
Thank you. Yeah. I doubt you've heard them all, but I mean, I know what you mean. I think they're all wonderful myself. Yeah,
they are. I mean, they have that sound, that signature sound.
And, it is, yeah, that's what I do. I have no capacity to play any other genres of music at all. I can't, you know.
Yeah.
I have the horrors of turning up at someone's party and they have an acoustic guitar there and say, "Hey, you do music, give us a song." It's like, you never, "Hey, come back, come back." No, I can't play other people's music, and I can't play instruments in any sort of traditional way, and I've got absolutely no interest in, I don't listen to a lot of music, I don't follow the music scene, I don't follow bands, I don't, you know, things come to my attention, which I like, I'm sure, but I'm, you know, being part of that music industry intensely during my 20s killed my passion for bands and music and things. I read, you know, I haven't got Spotify, but I've got a Kindle, you know, so it's like each, you know, I do photography, I read,
yeah.
I have my inspirations from elsewhere, and that's my loss, you know. I mean, I still play music, you know, in the kitchen Friday evening, bit of Delida, a bit of Patsy Cline, you know, so things that are,
oh yeah,
you know, things that I like, you know. But as far as, you know, searching out new bands and new sounds and things like that, I've not done that since the 90s, maybe, I don't know, maybe the 80s even, you know, because I just haven't, you know, have enough music in my life that when I switch off in my studio, the last thing I want to do is go, "Well, I've just finished in this studio, I think I'll go play some records now." No. That's not really, there's nothing attractive about that for me at all. The fact is, this is what I do, and this is how I do it.
I mean,
it can be quite disappointing revelation to people who are music fans, but if I want to continue doing things the way that I do them, with the results that I get, the least thing the last thing I want to do is be listening to whatever the new kids on the block are doing. Not the new kids on the block, but you know what.
Yeah.
But that would be the last thing that I would want to do. But you know, whoever's, you know, whatever the vibe is now, whatever that might be. You mentioned being a teenager and listening to these old things. Let today's teenagers be listening to these things. Let me just get on with what I'm doing, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, you know, before I forget, I wanted to do a big shout out to Shauna at Shameless Promotion PR.
Yes, thank you, Shauna.
Yeah, Shauna, she's great. Yeah, she's amazing. She helped with
highly of you as well.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Shauna. Thank you. Well, you know, we're looking forward to more music from you. And I'm looking forward to playing the album. More of the music from Pearl Diving, and I know you released the earlier EP, Mockingbird Love.
Have you heard that? It should be pointed out to anyone that's not heard these. I'm not being obtuse by releasing EPs and albums. Like, not just put it all together into one big thing. It's just that Mockingbird Love just is 13 minutes long. It's four pieces of music, and it works at its best if you just play it from start to finish.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a different vibe to the album. It's still unmistakably me, but it's a different vibe. And the next EP is coming, same again. It's a different. This is why I kind of sequence things into groups and go together. The one that's coming out January is a doozy.
Yeah.
I like that one. But yeah, I'm just a bit. I'm doing this just now. Maybe it's just because it's winter and I'm in the studio because it's warmer than outside. You know, could be that as well. Works.
Yeah. What was the inspiration behind Pearl Diving? Were you was there something that triggered that emotion?
The trigger. Well, if you let's put it this way. People that know me, when they read the song titles, they kind of know what this is all about because there's been lots of things happening in my life that are reflected in the way that I work. In general, a defining sort of characteristic of this record for me is that I made the whole thing here thanks to our pandemic that we've been having. And I've been recalling upon a great amount of travel records, you know, records where I know that I was off camping somewhere or I was off on the other side of the world. And this one is really made in this room. And it's really the first record that I made in this room. Apart from another flower, which was made in this room as well. You know, generally I tend to go to other places, other studios, other environments, then bring everything here and mix it and finish it. But this was just like, well, I'm not going anywhere. I don't want to go out and get, you know, COVID and, you know, die.
That would be during that time.
That would be pretty sort of, you know, don't think it would be fun. So I sort of decided just to have another. It's terrible light in, you know, this time of year for taking pictures and things. So I just move into an environment where I can be creative.
Yeah.
I mean, I was kind of doing quite a few other things while I was making this record, all to do with my life and I guess my age and I guess things like that. Not necessarily being nostalgic at all, but just being reflective, looking at things that, you know, happened in my life and things I'd recently discovered about myself. It was just, you know, just the usual kind of things that one puts into a record, except with the exception that my voice is a bunch of guitars and baritone guitars and, you know, lap steel guitars, and I use them to, you know, hit the melancholy button. And it's just, you know, that's, I don't think I find that difficult anymore, but certainly it's like challenging than using human voice, which is an instant connection to other human beings, you know. because you know, with all the nuance and the of the human voice, you can feel the emotion. And I strive to do that with my instruments, you know.
I see that.
Yeah.
So you know, a lot of people cover the Cocteau Twins. What do you think of some of the covers of the Cocteau Twins?
I think I've not really heard very many, but I think it's quite brave because it's I think if someone takes the song and reinterprets it completely in their way, then that's fantastic. Yeah. I think if someone tries to sound like the Cocteau Twins, it's like,
oh yeah, yeah. I don't think they can.
Well, they probably can because you know it's not that difficult, really. You just have to unlearn everything you know about music and approach your instruments in a different way. That's all. If there's a strength in the quality of the songwriting that can be pulled through into, you know, the song existing in a different sort of audio sort of sphere, then that's great, you know. I'm quite flattered, but I'm not really very interested in that, if you know what I mean. It doesn't, you know, it's just old, you know.
Yeah, I've heard, you know, Trance of the Sun did the Thinner the Air cover, and Azam Ali did the Shallow Than Halo cover, and I thought I thought it was beautiful. Yeah.
Well, you call yourself a Cocteau Twins fan there. What do you think of people doing that? What do you think? How does that make you feel when you hear that? You're the Cocteau Twins fan here, so tell me.
Yeah, I like it. It depends.
You like it?
Yeah, it depends.
You know, I mean, it's hugely flattering.
Yeah,
you know, I have to say that's really nice, but I've made these records already, so I don't really need to.
Well, you know, congratulations on your new album, and
thank you.
And I'll be playing it more often on the show and then when I play the interview as well.
Thanks. That'll be really, really cool. But have a go at Mockingbird Love because I'm particularly attached to that little EP, because it's a very short EP, but it's so kind of concise, and it's the first thing that I'd actually dared. It's like sometimes when you're, I don't know, just sort of hanging about in the shadows, you don't find yourself being judged too badly. But when, as soon as you make something new, you have to be prepared to have people going, yeah, it's great, but I really like the old stuff better. And therefore, you just feel shit about yourself. So this is the first thing that I felt, you know, for a while. I thought, you know what, fuck them all. I'm just going to just put this out because this is really relevant. And it's just a really interesting little, very short little journey. Put my foot into the water about doing this. And I have to say, I'll say this on record now, that I'm really, really happy that I put that out now, because I was reluctant to for quite some time. So I'm glad I did that. It was kind of like walking through the fear, you know, of being sort of like treated indifferently, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's great, but I really like the old stuff.
No, I mean, it's great. I mean, we're looking forward to your next album. And
yeah. I got a few things next year as well. I don't want to talk too far ahead. But I have got set amount of resources here. So we'll be seeing more music, I think.
Yes, great. So the robinguthrie.com?
Robinguthrie.com, which is currently down, but it should be up, I promised, within about 48 hours or something. Okay. You'll get me there, you'll get me at Robin Bandcamp. Robin Guthrie official site is my Facebook thing, which I actually do. One of my children does my Instagram at the moment because I don't know how to log into it. That's the kind of thing. It's a family affair.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, that is good. Yeah,
they must be so proud of you. proud to be
well, in a sort of rolling your eyes sort of way, because before anything, I'm the father, so that's the way it should be, isn't it? Yeah.
Okay. Well, you know, thank you so much for coming on the show and you know, talking a little bit about your music.
That's fine. I'm very happy to have done so, because you know what? I'm since getting stuck straight into this remix now. We're going to sit in my studio, have my breakfast, have 3 cups of coffee, and I'm good to go. So I'll turn this around, we'll switch the camera off, and I'll get to work.
Thank you. I really appreciate this interview, and you know, maybe in the future again, if you have another album out, we can do this again. I'm always love to.
We'll certainly have some more things out, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much, Robin.
No problem, Anne. Yeah. Anne, isn't it? Says DJ Nocturna on the screen here, and I thought that's a very strange name for a woman. There you go.
Oh, it means dark, the dark.
It means nighttime, yeah.
Yeah, nighttime, yeah.
One of our old-fashioned European languages. Yeah. Well, listen, yeah, thanks for staying up late and doing this. I get the impression you stay up late anyway, so that's...
My name is Nocturna.
Yeah, exactly. That's the clues in the name, yeah. And, thanks for taking time to do this, and I will be... You got my email if you think of anything you need, just give us a shout, you know?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah, no worries.
Thank you.
You have a good night. I'll have a good day, okay?
Yeah. And this will be audio. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.